game between AHQ and Beşiktaş here at the League of Legends Midseason Invitational. We have the Ahri and Kalista bans right off the bat. And of course, the Albus Dumbledoge matchup.
Yeah, and if you look at the bans coming in from Beşiktaş beforehand, it was LeBlanc and Urgot when they were on blue side. That's not two champions AHQ uses a lot, if they even play them at all. So I'm not expecting those bans to come in from them. They can change that up a little bit. Thresh is a support ban I think you should aim towards AHQ Esports, because it's so good at setting up these ganks in the bottom lane. And we know they just love to camp their bottom lane so hard. Mountain, he comes down there multiple times. I think that has to be banned. LeBlanc is not a champion you need to ban against Westar. He barely plays it.
Yeah, he didn't in fact play it at all over the course of the playoffs for the LMS. He was only on that TF, Fizz, Karthus, Cho'Gath, and Zed. So. Yeah. A little bit of a curiosity there.
Even Zed as well. I mean, Zed in the current meta is not that strong of a pick because it's so hard for him to find targets. The window for him to snowball is so small. I really don't think it's banned you have to use against Westar. If Thresh gets locked in with Mountain getting Rek'Sai as well, you know what's gonna happen. Also, the 2v2 roam they have together into the enemy jungle is so effective. That's what they use against Fnatic.
So first pick Rek'Sai for AHQ. Now, Theocles hovering over Warwick, I don't think we're going to see that locked in.
No, but we may see an Urgot yet. It is a bit puzzling.
Certainly.
That the AHQ yeah. pick was the Rek'Sai first. There are a lot of course, priority junglers still on the table.
Yeah.
And Anne is a player who likes to play that Urgot.
Well, normally, at least when we do see AHQ and what they have run quite a lot, is Anne as one of the main damage dealers. And then Westar often even goes, I'm going to call it a supported role, by picking like Karthus and building Rylai's and kind of kiting for Anne in this team fight. So Urgot in that case wouldn't really fit in too well for him. He wants some of these high damage dealers.
Okay.
And also one of these laners, like Kalista, if that's the case he goes for, they can snowball with a Thresh.
You can see they've just really got a lot of confidence with Dumbledoge on this Morgana. He did make a big difference with it in their run to get here. But again, you know, is it really worth that early pick when they could have taken something like a top laner as well as that Sivir? You think?
I think
no.
His priority on Morgana is quite odd quite unnecessary as well.
You're not worried about it getting taken away.
It's very much comfort picks.
Yeah.
You are a wildcard team here. You're just here to basically do your best. We've seen how much fun these players have between games. They know they're not going in as a favorite. So they want to make sure they have comfort picks and maybe something where they can create some picks. And yeah, the Dumbledoge build we saw in the wildcard tournament, was it Hourglass into Luden's Echo,
yes.
And then he tried to get a death cap as well,
yes.
And they support Morgana. So clearly it's his kind of champion.
I like that. I like the more AP built on supports, more damage in general, the better. But it didn't work out so far today for him. Looks like maybe Janna, maybe Gnar for AHQ.
Okay, so they are.
It's like it will be.
Yeah, they're changing it up a little bit from AHQ Esports
yeah.
here. Not running a Thresh this time around. And then, as we have seen, I mean, Kalista was banned and Sivir was taken away. That's the 280 carries we've seen from Ant today. Maybe they want to go for a bit more late game scaling and have that Janna as the needed protection.
Well, plus with the Sivir coming in as well. And the one, I suppose, I'm grasping at straws a little bit, but the one nice thing I think about that early Morgana pick is it at least prevents the other team from taking Thresh. They have to think twice about that lane matchup, at the very least.
That is true. Looks like we might have a Cassiopeia in mid for energy. Certainly has been a pretty strong pick so far across the board today.
But not one that he has been heavily playing.
Two times Lulu in yeah. the mid lane. He has the counter pick potentially for Westar. I would save my mid pick here. Because we, again,
yeah.
if you look at a champion pool for Westar, if he looks like a Twisted Fate, you can play a bit of a lane pool against it and try and get a few kills and use that as a way for you to snowball, because we know Beşiktaş has to make plays in the early game. I'm not sure showing your mid lane pick is necessary already.
Yeah, it seems like against such a strong mid laner like Westar, you need to try to counter him as much as you can. But energy with that confidence, the Cassiopeia,
yeah.
the jungle Gragas as well coming in here.
And especially also because you've already seen the top lane pick
yeah.
from AHQ, so there's like no surprise left, really. Maybe he's just afraid of Westar taking the Cassiopeia, but
maybe.
But it's not a champion he's been
again,
playing.
That's the same thing. We don't really know what's been happening in scrims this week, and obviously these teams don't really know each other too well. But if you just look at the player front for AHQ, some of the bans and some of the picks here are not ones you have to be afraid of from AHQ's side.
Well, two final picks here for AHQ. Maybe the Jinx. How do you think that would fit into this composition? Pretty decently with the Janna, of course, and always a great late-game hyper carry.
Yeah, I really like this. I think this is showing a new dimension to AHQ's play. Obviously, they are coming in as a heavy favorite. And there it is, the Westar Twisted Fate.
It's locked in, and so now, I mean, is this kind of a nightmare scenario for Energy here with Cassiopeia? It's kind of a nightmare scenario in general, because that TF can show up in any lane.
Well, I mean, the matchup itself is good for Energy. He will have control of this lane here, and will have very, very good trades against Twisted Fate. The problem is Twisted Fate is one of these champions who can always play really safe, farm from long range, and then impact the other lanes instead of his own. I mean, you don't really see a TF solo someone out.
One problem with the TF pick right here is he does have a limited ability to gank. There are double spell shields going to be in the bottom lane, so it will be actually quite hard to get onto some of these AD carries if he wants to port into the back line. So that means Energy probably should be taking cleanse.
True.
See it often, at least in this case where this one stun can basically ruin your entire day for him, but if he wants to try and completely snowball the lane, he needs an offensive summoner in this case, or at least run maybe a ghost, because you know Twisted Fate runs ghost flash to try and catch up with him.
And is this going to be a top lane Diana, or do you think it's going to be a top lane Cassiopeia and mid Diana?
I think it's going to be a top lane Cassiopeia, and the reason why is we know that Energy is a Diana player. He actually had some pretty impressive objective steals, including a Baron with that Diana.
That is true.
Yeah.
Still sticking with the Ignite, though.
I mean, we called how the Cassiopeia mid, if it was the mid lane pick, would have been weird showing it and not saving as a last pick. And clearly, Projectors here fooled us as well and just decided to use it as a flex pick. So I kind of like that adaptation. Diana as well, once she hits level 6, can set up ganks on Twisted Fate so, so effectively. Gragas is one of the best early junglers in terms of the gank and the CC he does provide. He won't match the Rek'Sai in terms of damage. But Diana dashing in, knocking back a TF, and then a Gragas following, that should be a kill for Projectors.
I like it too, and this is what we were talking about. This is Projectors trying to take charge of the early game, and they're really going to need to do it against a team like AHQ, especially an AHQ that took out Fnatic.
Yeah, absolutely. However, going late, that Aegis, that Locket, going to be very effective up against Projectors' composition. And I'm a little bit worried, but we'll see if HQ can pull it back into the late game right here. Westor will be probably pretty heavily focusing on the top side, so Thaldrin, who really is one of the main sources of damage for his team, is going to have to come up big against a Gnar, a Rek'Sai, and a TF, all trying to take him down.
That's right, and remember, guys, to send those tweets, hashtag AHQWin or hashtag BJKWin. Who do you think is going to take it here in our second to last game of the night? It's been a long day, but the games have been awesome, and we are ready to move on to Summoner's Rift for AHQ versus Projectors here at the Midseason Invitational. Welcome to Summoner's Rift.
Look at Westor here, changing up the Summoners. Not running Ghost on Twisted Fate in this matchup.
Wow.
He will be looking to push it in early on, try and force Energy to sit on the tower and then be ready for these 2v2 trades when a Rek'Sai joins, and that's where the Ignite can be very, very powerful for him, as long as he can spot where Gragas is coming from and he doesn't get instantly gipped in the 2v2 fight.
Yeah, I wonder if, like you're saying, this is an adaptation because he doesn't necessarily have that big gank pressure in the bottom lane. He has to figure out another place on the map to make a play.
Dancing time.
It's like Westor is already here with the gold card.
Huh. He's going to find Nardius in the bush here. Uh-oh, Nardius may be in a little bit of trouble. He's going to have to burn that flash early. Hit with the gold card anywhere. They're going to chase a little ways. Getting that summoner early on, though, is pretty nice.
I really love this level one from AHQ. You have your bottom lane take a standard route from the tri-bush into the small bushes, like they normally would do. You know, you don't really expect too much from it. And then the Twisted Fate has run at the tier one tower, hogging the wall on the way, and then you just sneak up from the side, forcing a summoner from Nardis here. So good little start from them. We could potentially see an early gank now in this bottom lane. We've seen it a few times already today. Force that flash level one, have your jungler come down, take red buff, and just go for the first gank.
Well, yeah, I'd imagine, like, especially against a Sivir that isn't exactly the most mobile AD carry in the world, it'd be pretty easy to set something up if they're not careful.
Yeah, not even see what Nardis wants to do. I mean, Grump would be a standard start for them and start pushing the lane, but that is, of course, risky without that flash, so you might have to think twice if you are Projectors at the moment.
Yeah, pings from HQ going down on that Grump because they do have that ward there, so they are going to see that this is going to be taken.
I'm a little bit surprised we don't see a lane swap from HQ in the sense that the Cassiopeia is a fairly easy champion to dive in these swaps here. If she's sitting there trying to farm in a 1v2 situation, you just push it into tower, send up your jungler in your top lane, even your jungler alone, honestly, and you kill her in the early stages. But they take the one-on-one lane, so they have to be able to camp this lane now with the Rek'Sai. It's something Team Solomon failed to do in the first game against Fnatic, where we had this matchup in top, Cassiopeia versus the Gnar. we have to see the Rek'Sai make some plays on the top side of the map, and we have to see Besiktas realize that's going to happen, get that early Rift Scuttle on the top side, or at least a ward down.
Well, it seems like HQ's plan is to make that earlier assault right here. They're still trading. No, they just have the level one and level two, but they did give the Krugs over to Rek'Sai in this instance, so just trying to get a little bit more farm and experience on the jungler, see if they can abuse the...
Look at the move, though. Look.
Really need to be careful about pushing up this far if you're Bezhishtas right now. Here comes Mountain. And, oh man, they are really far up. Nardius and Dumbledoge may be in trouble here. They're backing up now, but is it soon enough coming in? The Dark Binding Dodge, there's a knock up onto Nardius in trouble. Oh, the Whirlwind doesn't connect, though. Is Dumbledoge in trouble? Theocles coming from behind. There's a Flash Exhaust. First Blood goes over to Albus. Meanwhile, more action. Oh, on goes down from the turret, and AHQ has to retreat. It's a one for one. And dare I say, turning out a little bit better for... Nardius there.
Yeah, well, honestly, HQ knew Theocles' jungle timing from his route, the fact that they had the ward at the Gromp right there. So it shouldn't have been a surprise if they make a gank at around this time that this Gragas could come back for a counter gank and getting just a little bit too deep under the turret.
Yeah, now with Mountain showing himself on the bottom side, the Cassiopeia Gnar matchup is, of course, heavily in favor of Thaldrin up in this top lane. He's already been pushing down, forcing the first TP. But we just mentioned how you get that flash early from the level one, then you go for the gank with the Rek'Sai. That's why taking Drum and start pushing the lane was risky for Besiktas, and they did somewhat get punished, but then managed to turn around by simply, dare I say, punish HQ, but then not respecting the jungler coming down as well.
And now we've got this pickaxe onto this Sivir, and the first blood going onto a support, so it's not going to be great things for HQ. And even with that, a little bit of a faster jungling start right there from the Rek'Sai. Trying to camp West.
Theocles really wants to make something happen in the mid lane, but all he's going to get is a gold card and some damage in return.
It's not really a great way to gank that lane right now because Diana can't close unless you use the flash.
Kind of casually sauntering up. That's not a good lane gank idea. Okay. You say so.
All you want to do for Diana in the mid lane, pre level 6, is just ward her side so she can safely sit and farm. She's obviously a melee champion, and she's one of the easiest to gank when you have the likes of a Twisted Fate with a stun card to simply lock it down. So the warding...
The Mountain may be coming through here. Yeah, they're back under turret.
A full HP. This is going to be a risky one.
Yeah,
from
I don't know if you'd want to dive this. This seems like a bit of a risk. Well, dodges Fermented Soil. Dumbledoge going to investigate, going to find the Rek'Sai. There's a knockup. He's going to take some serious damage. Remember, no flash. He'll be able to back off without taking too much, I suppose.
Honestly, showing there as a jungler just, I don't think, was worth it at all because that's going to inspire some play into the top lane. A little bit more aggression probably from Thaldrin.
Especially also because if you look at a topside jungle for Mountain and AHQ, there is everything up at the moment. He's not been taking anything, so it's going to be a delayed blue buff coming in when it spawns the second time, unless they want to give the very first over to Westor in the first situation. And also, there's been no pressure on topside.
That would have been a hilarious Gromp steal, but we've seen stranger things. We've seen Dragon Stone with Whirlwind. It does happen. And Mountain may be making a play on the mid lane here, but I think he wants his mid laner there first. He's going to go in. Are they going to catch energy here? There's a Chilling Smite. Energy making it out, having to burn that flash, though.
Fischio, why will no one gank the top lane Cassiopeia's today?
Leave them alone. They're just trying to lane.
Really don't know. I really don't know. Is it because she has like 5 jumps? No, wait a minute.
They're just weirded out by it.
Run away from people. And you have a knock up and a slow from an R.
Oh, well,
my prayers may be answered.
You shall receive.
Westor.
He's level 6, isn't he?
It's going to be a 3v1 in the top lane. Westor, he's not spotted by any wards in his mid lane.
I think the snake may be in trouble. There's a teleport coming in. Thaldrin, can he escape? There's a gold card. A lot of damage coming in. That is an easy kill for Ziv there.
And you have to prepare for that. As a jungler, if you know Westor is going to be hitting 6, we did see the recall from Diana after the flash was burned, and Gragas moves into mid lane to cover to make sure they don't lose a whole lot of farm. But at the same time, that TF leaves the lane. You got to back way the hell off that tower.
Well, it looks like they're going to be able to take a dragon here. Maybe. We'll see how much pressure on and Albus want to put on this. Looks like they're just going to let him have it.
Yeah, trading the top kill and a lot of damage on the top towers. There's no teleport for Besiktas here for that dragon. So AHQ definitely saying here, we don't mind losing the first dragon in trying to get an advantage in our top lane, the one-on-one, gank that immobile Cassiopeia as well. Mountain now getting a red buff for himself. We'll be able to get the first blue buff over to Westar as well once he goes down to that bottom side or his own top side of the jungle with the Grump and everything. We're going to have to see from Besiktas now what's around this mid lane, because first of all, you want to make sure Energy can start playing aggressive against Westar, and you also want to spot next time he has ulti when he's moving to these lanes here. One thing he's calling, oh, he's missing, but if that means you have to play passive every single time TF just leaves the lane, then you end up giving CS in lane, you end up losing a lot of pressure just by this Twisted Fate going out of his lane. So you need these wards here on the sides to spot when Westar is moving.
That said, I think that the overwhelming likelihood is that he's going topside. So in this particular game, due to the Sivir and Morgana, and here we go, Mountain coming back in.
Yeah, there's a knock up on the Thaldrin. Ziv coming in. He's about to go Meganar fairly soon. Can Thaldrin get away? There's Theokles coming in. And it looks like they'll be able to push HQ in. In fact, they might be able to get a kill. The turnaround, there's a stun onto Ziv. Daddy's still in trouble. There's a kill for Twisted Fate. Meanwhile, Energy tries to make something happen as well. Westar comes in. Another gold card lands. Will it be another kill? Oh, not quite. Theokles manages to take down Westar. Energy on the run now, but I don't think he's going to make it out. That boomerang says no. Meanwhile, more action down in the bot lane. Albus trying to get away, but the damage, it was going to be too high, but he used that flash, made it out. Teleport for Ziv just to make sure things are safe. Meanwhile, a bit more jungle v jungle in the top lane.
So much action right now here. And AHQ, they're putting the focus on top lane. We talked about it earlier in the game, how they were ignoring the lane, but now two ganks in a row. Mountain ulted up there, another one onto the Cassiopeia. 0-2 now for him, but at least Besiktas did get a kill in return.
Stacking that tier relatively slowly, however. Not a lot of item buys yet for either of these teams, but Mountain pulling a little bit ahead in the jungle, though not opting for that Sightstone immediately. Westar going to go ahead and grab the blue buff.
Yep, a little bit of a lead early on for AHQ, but you know, where do you go from here? How do you start to snowball this?
I just keep diving Cassiopeia over and over again.
There you go.
You can just see what Westar was doing right here. He placed the pink on the way back from the blue buff, as you can see in the minimap, right next to the mid lane. So it's very easy for him now to move that way through the lane, knows he's not spotted by anything, and just ulted to that top lane over and over and over. Besiktas has to clear out this pink ward you see on your screen now, otherwise Westar will always be able to get the gank off.
And Theokles has to start playing more to the top side. If you look at all of the Rek'Sai tunnels in the top side jungle right now, with these double globals, it's an extremely easy setup for AHQ.
Yeah, it's pretty amazing, actually, that all those tunnels have been able to be set up without taking down. That's like a real lack of attention from Theokles.
Well, every time Theokles walks topside these days, they keep scrapping with him in his own jungle.
That's true.
So I think a bit scared of a rather tenuous position up on that side of the map at the moment.
Oh, Mountain just going through some of his own jungle, grabbing that red buff. But a passive moment here. Oh, never mind. We're going to find Theokles right away. Energy coming down to lend a bit of support here. Mountain knocked against the wall by that ultimate. Will he be able to get away here? That's a lot of damage coming from Energy, and that's a kill for the mid laner. Meanwhile, some more action down in bot lane. It feels like whenever there's a fight elsewhere on the map, that's like the cue for the bot lane to just immediately start fighting too.
So we've seen now how Theokles and Energy together roaming into the jungle of AHQ. They had the wards on the bottom side around this mid lane, and simply just by finding Mountain near the red buff can take him out. No response from Westar. Super easy pick for them. That's one way to get back here, because you might not be able to save this Cassiopeia in the top lane, because she will die every single time they do this.
Here we go.
Maybe
double
you focus on the bottom side instead.
Again, TF coming in to help complete this game. Thaldrin gets the double stun off, but he's still in big trouble. Another easy kill for AHQ. Meanwhile, again, more action down the bot lane. Dumbledoge getting a little bit low, and they actually got the kill on it on, too.
I think it's fair for Besiktas now to say, Thaldrin, my friend, you're 0-3, you're on your own. You're not even worth that much gold anymore. Just try and get the farm you can. We're going to control Dragon instead, and we're going to try and take over the mid and bottom lane and push those two lanes in and try and simply get some gold for you.
So is Thaldrin kind of just relegated to teamfight stun bot at this point?
For now, at least.
If he's lucky.
For now, at least.
If he can get close enough, I think, without getting stunned and dying himself.
That's going to be tough. Meanwhile, turrets going down across the map. Looks like Besiktas might be able to get two of them right here.
And that's a super, super good response. Yeah. AHQ keep investing a minimum of three guys to killing the Cassiopeia in the top lane.
Let's watch this action down the bot lane.
Just a nice binding into an all-in, I would assume, from Dumbledoge.
Yep.
You do see it.
So walking up right there.
Yeah, maybe getting a little bit too far.
Finding Dumbledore. Number two.
And yep, there's a stun. There's the pool, and so much damage coming in from Nardius right now.
It's a great black shield right there too on the Whirlwind.
And you can see the way Dumbledore and Nardius was playing the lane. As soon as they saw the ulti from Westor, they were waiting, because saying, okay, I don't want to risk going all in, and he then teleports down behind us. But when they saw a top lane, then you could go for the all-in with Dumbledore and pick up the kills. So Besiktas, despite having a 0-3 top laner, is making plays on the other side of the map.
And funny enough, like Thaldrin has kept up in CS as well, too. So it's bad, but it could be worse, I suppose.
As long as you can keep making plays, Jinx is 0-2 as well. That's the thing we have to remember.
Yeah.
Dragon is spawning. That can be the second one for Besiktas. Let's see on the map here. No teleport for Sif in the top lane. So this can be a 4v5. For the Turkish team, if they do to start this one up, they have good wards around it as well.
Yeah, they've got good position on this dragon. We'll see if they can follow up, though.
Yeah, however, HQ has a pretty strong hold on the center of the map right now.
Yeah.
Getting some of those wards behind the pit also. And they have to clear that minion wave out, but looks like HQ thinking about that top lane one more time, but they've been giving up a lot of objectives, like you were talking about, Divisio, for this, and Besiktas making the correct plays onto the bottom of the side of the map every time they have that attempt.
Yeah, they should just go Dragon now. No reason to chase for any kills up here in the top side. Obviously, they worry a little bit about losing a tier 2 tower as well. But this Dragon, HQ is not even close. You have double ping, you got the Rift Scuttler. You have the perfect setup to get two Dragons for 0-14 minutes in. So suddenly, this fifth Dragon becomes a thing you have to worry about if you are HQ. And just constantly ganking a Cassiopeia, while it is the strategy you should use in the start.
Uh-oh.
Oh boy, energy in the mid lane, he's caught Westor. There's Golkar, he's gonna try to teleport away! He didn't make it! Close call, but the Ignite finishes the job for energy. Nice duel there. Westor, maybe not quite as invulnerable as he may seem at times. That's two deaths, he's actually a little bit behind.
Well, this is the thing where HQ suddenly is on blue side and don't have that last pick for Westor, so they do risk getting a matchup that can snowball in favor of the other team. And with the Cassiopeia even tricking us on the caster desk.
That's true, yeah.
Besiktas did manage to then get Diana as a pick, get to level 6 from energy, and he's been playing very aggressive together with Theokles into the jungle, look for trades, look for skirmishes all the time. Gragas is such a fantastic jungler in the early stages, and he has that great scaling, obviously why he's such a strong pick in the current meta.
And Dumbledore too. I mean, I don't agree with the priority on the Morgana because I think they can always get it later in the draft, but at least he's justifying it a little bit here by landing all of these skill shots, by setting up the plays, and by getting Nardius ahead.
Yeah, clearly a very good Morgana player and one that his team puts a lot of faith in as well, too. Right now, Besiktas, they really want to take that final outer turret. We'll see if they can. They tried putting a bit of pressure on, but it's not working too much.
So what HQ have done now is if you look at Jinx and her items, despite being down 0-2, you have the BF, so you have pickaxe, and then you upgrade your boots to get some extra attack speed, and you start becoming a bit of a tower-killing machine. What they want to do now here is look towards this Diana with her, I'm not going to say complete lack of wave clear, but very risky wave clear, because she's sitting in that melee range of the minions. She has to stack it up to 3 with her passive as well, so she won't be able to instant clear waves. Twisted Fate and Jinx together can take down these towers so fast, so they can put focus on the mid lane
if they want to,
but more fights in the top lane.
Yeah, Thaldrin turns around, gets that Sun off Mountain, and Big Trouble flashes over the wall. Theokles is unable to follow. We'll see if Thaldrin can catch him. Meanwhile, Sif in a little bit of trouble, but not too much. He's going to be able to hop to safety, maybe, yeah. There might dive this, actually. Energy going in, grabbing that kill. Now, more trouble for AHQ. Sif in a little bit of trouble. There's a nice ult, though, from Albus that might save him. Meanwhile, Westor coming in, gets a lot of damage onto Dumbledore, who barely gets taken down. Turret helping out a little bit there. Another gold card loaded up. Can they catch Theokles? They're going to try. Sif goes Meganar. Another kill for AHQ. They're going to chase for now, but Nardius entering the fight. Big Gnar ult, though, comes in. Nice double whirlwind as well. Westor with another kill. Looks like they will.
Oh!
And from downtown, and with the Jinx Rocket, manages to end this fight for now. Oh, maybe I spoke too soon, though. Nardius still has a lot of damage, but he could get CC'd here enough. Westor throwing some in. They force the flash. And is this the end? Dare I say it? Yes, it is. Meanwhile, Oann manages to do a lot of damage. Probably takes down the spot turret.
That was close to the best fight HQ could have gotten right there. Despite even losing out in the start, not winning their 2v2 trade. Besiktas came in like one after one, diving onto the turret, didn't respect the Meganar and also the Westar with the ulti, while Jinx was just sitting bottom lane, free farm, tower. Suddenly, despite Besiktas doing so well in the start of the game by trying to get plays on the bottom lane.
That's right, and here a little bit low under the turret, so that prompts this dive from Energy. No chance of that Gnar going into Meganar form quite yet. And here comes the TP. I love the teleport placement right here. Does catch Dumbledoge in a relatively safe location for Westar. Still flashes back out to not take any follow-up damage. And then the chase is on right here. There's the Gnar at the right time, and he'll turn it around to get a two-man ult right here, actually.
And Nardius kind of walked into that one,
didn't he? Both Aldrin and Nardius kind of walked into that one.
And
smack.
The kill.
Yep.
I mean, that kill was obviously all Jinx. She had to take
Oh, yeah, of
that's
course.
How it is. Come on. Yep.
She did all the work.
She killed some minions and got a tower.
She aimed, pressed R, and sat back and waited.
Really just Besiktas here, diving onto that tower, feeling very confident at first.
Yep, Siv.
Now we want to kill Siv.
A little bit of damage. There's a knockback with the ultimate. Thaldrin doing tons of damage. I don't think Gnar's going to make it out of this one. Easy kill.
He's worth gold now.
Oh, Westar coming in. Or is he? Oh, wait, he's going to the bot lane. Energy trying to fight him off, though. Mountain gets a knock up. There's the Zonius from Westar. Is it going to give him enough time? That's still a ton of damage from that Diana. He backs away. Oh!
Oh!
And Elvis nearly saved him, and Energy managed to pick up that kill anyway. But now he's in a bit of trouble. No summoners available. Can he make it out? Elvis trying to help out. There is a kill for Mountain. Hello, Rocket. Goodbye, Rocket. Hello, Nardius. Goodbye, Nardius.
We really see how strong Diana can be, even after completing just 1.5 items for the Abyssal first item. So Westar's damage against Energy here is not very high. So in a 1v3 situation, he trades anyway, gets a kill for himself. And meanwhile, up in the top lane, Siv went down. The ulti, or the jump, sorry, got interrupted by the ulti from Theokles.
And Thaldrin as well, in spite of being behind early in this game, in spite of having to stack up this tier, is going to be getting up there in Cassiopeia stacks pretty soon. And if we look at his build, the tier into the Rylai's here, you can see how much work the Rylai's does. Siv was simply unable to get away in a long lane.
Yeah.
If he gets caught out right there, even though it's a lower damage build compared to a lot of Cassiopeia builds that we see, it can stick you there, and there's no way to play around it long enough. You're just going to eat a million Twin Fangs, and that's the end.
Well, yeah, he kind of needed a way to be able to participate in team fights, even though being down and getting a little bit more tankiness, getting that slow, really helps. Mount trying to go through the wall, gets knocked back out by Theokles. There's that chilling smite to try to escape, but Dumbledoge, oh, he hits a max range binding. Is Mountain in trouble here? There's the ult from Theokles to knock him back, and there's a kill for Besiktas.
Yeah, Mountain just warding on his own here. Meanwhile, Westar and Ant, they want to get this mid tower. We mentioned this earlier, how you can move that Jinx to the mid lane with a Twist of Fate and take down towers super fast.
Yeah.
So they did get the last auto turret down at least. Really opens up the map. But they gotta worry about these dragons, because once again, they're going topside to get a kill.
Well, Westar popped his ult. They're gonna go all in on the Thaldrin. There's the ultimate. Doesn't help him out, though. Those Krugs never saw that ult coming, man.
Well, the wild cards were already in the air by the time the stun hit, so
yep.
Ain't no thing really for Westar to finish that off. Now, Westar, it's like he may be going for a Sheen and perhaps a Lichbane as his next item. And when you have the Jinx and you have the Twisted Fate in this game, I think you really need to start taking that gold lead here. Start playing to a more split push style where if they don't defend a turret, you could kill it in a wave.
And that's really going to be the thing here. If you're AHQ and you go late game, you're not necessarily looking for the big 5-on-5 team fight against the Cassiopeia, Diana, and so on. Instead, you got that split push because you got double, or you got triple global even. Twist of Fate, you got the Rek'Sai ult, and you got the teleport from the Gnar. So you can do a 1-3-1 setup very effectively from AHQ side, where you can either decide to have Twist of Fate already in a side lane pushing in on his own, or you leave him in the mid lane with the Jinx. You have Rek'Sai one lane, Gnar in the other lane, and you simply play around these minion waves so well, and you get onto these towers and just take them down so fast.
Nardius ulting. They're going to try to get a kill on Gnar here, but that's a lot of damage. Okay, ultimate for Dumbledoge has to get flashed out of. That's two ultimates used for no kills, just a summoner. Meanwhile, they're going to try to take a little bit more jungle, but here comes the rest of AHQ. Gold card loaded up, hits the Theokles. That's a lot of damage coming in from Jinx. Goodbye, Gragas. Another kill for Ann. And they're not done yet. Wow, this fight may continue, actually. Dumbledoge Gonna get a little bit Nardia slowed down.
They have TP in the ward now.
Yeah, they do, and they're gonna come in. Zif already Meganard's almost run out. Meanwhile, a lot of damage on energy. There's another kill for Westor. Nardius and Dumbledoge backing off. Can Thaldrin escape here? I don't think so. Turns around, gets the ult. It's not enough though. A double kill now for Westor. Nardius on the disengage. There's another kill for Ann, and another huge fight. It's gonna be an ace for Beşiktaş.
And they should just turn right onto Baron right now. No reason not to go for that objective. That's what they're looking for. 22 minutes in this game. Yep. I mean, we talked about some of AHQ's Baron struggles, but they actually are going to pull it off this time around with a good call. They did only get 45% of the Barons throughout their 9-1 playoff run. So this has not been a team that's been playing around Baron particularly well.
It's been all about dragons for AHQ. Yep. Typically not even that strong in the laning phase. But then they set up dragons really well, create some picks before a big team fight, and use that to get the 5 dragons. So this is once again Beşiktaş invading in and somewhat over chasing on AHQ, and then being caught out once AHQ decides to group up as a team. We see the TP coming in with the ward just being placed, but it's already 4v5, and energy just gets instantly bursted down, stunned from Westor, and now the Jinx is going to go crazy. The TF, there's no threat really for AHQ here.
Yeah, just another great fight for AHQ. Beşiktaş, just from the very beginning, not a lot they can do.
Yeah, Westor managed to pop a wild card there right before going into Zonya's as he started to get focused, and then just getting excited cleanup from that point forward. Baron yep. goes over to AHQ.
I gotta say, Ann's ultimates for the most part have been really spot on.
One thing about the current meta game of League of Legends is that while 1-3-1 compositions are very hard to pull off because of the emphasis on team fighting around objectives like Dragon and like Baron, if you can actually get a Baron with one of these comps that is more skirmish oriented and based around split pushing, all of a sudden it becomes immensely, immensely strong because there's not really a good way to defend against it from most team compositions right here. So since they can actually push all three lanes simultaneously, and they've got that very rapid kill pressure on towers with Jinx and TF, this is a really dangerous situation.
Yeah. And that's also why AHQ has decided in this game to value getting towers down to open up this map even more.
Right.
Then taking dragons. Even the third dragon when it spawned, they could have gone down and contested it, but they decided to gank the top lane again, get a kill, get a tier 2 tower, simply so they get all these lanes pushing so far down with minions. You always get that Baron threat as well once you have these tier 2 towers down, almost down
from them. Westor.
So there's so many split pushing options.
Oh boy. Thaldrin trying to defend that top lane. Westor did TP in there. With that ultimate, Theokalis taking a lot of damage. Oh, Ziv over the wall, misses his stun though. He might live to regret this, or not live to regret this actually. Gnar ultimate doesn't save him. A kill for Thaldrin. Ziv getting a little bit overexcited there.
He might die to regret this, doesn't quite have the same ring to it.
That's true, yeah. I mean, you know, the player lived at least, right? We hope. I'm getting excited over that one, and I would imagine the AHQ fans are as well. Meanwhile, more pressure in this mid lane. And here comes Siakali's Mountain, maybe in a little bit of trouble here. There's the stun, another Dark Binding comes in. Dumbledoge locks him down with that ultimate. It's gonna be maybe, yes, another kill for Nardius. Oh, but answered right back by Ann. I know, right? Jeez, these alts.
Ann has been on fire.
He really has, man. He's hit so many rockets, West.
And Dumbledoge.
Yeah.
We need some large rocks on this Morgana here.
That's right.
Hourglass first, Luden's Echo second. If we ever get to that point, sadly, you also get so late in the game where magic penetration is super important. So even though you have all that AP, you do no damage.
It's a little bit trickier, yeah. But here's the thing, though. If we do get later on in the game, and Beşiktaş does threaten that fourth and fifth dragon, is that maybe their only kind of key to come back at this point?
It will be, yeah. At this point of the game,
yeah.
That fifth dragon where they're hoping to force HQ down to a team fight is gonna be the way for Beşiktaş to get back. In terms of stopping this split push, it is so hard because if you look at the members, okay, Diana is very strong in a one-on-one. Oh. The Cassiopeia has the damage, but she will get ganked by Rek'Sai, Twist of Fate, whatever, will yeah. come up and just turn into 2v1 and kill Thaldrin again and again. So he cannot sit and hold the split push. It's only energy who can do it.
And you can see AHQ putting a lot more priority on this dragon now. They don't want to let Beşiktaş get that fourth. And so far, so good.
Got enough gold, you have an item advantage, you got yeah. enough towers down.
One thing I'm a little disturbed about with AHQ is the lack. Well, they've got the locket on the support right here, but
maybe the dragon.
Maybe wanting just a little bit more MR, especially on the jungler here, a little bit late for Mountain. Going for that Warmogs instead.
That's actually a pretty big boost, too, to get that first dragon at this point in the game. That 6% AP and AD really actually is a lot more now.
So good for HQ. And also, yeah, just as you just mentioned or asked before here, how can Besiktas win the game? Well, there was a fifth dragon potentially. That's now gone.
Yeah.
For another 6 minutes for HQ, so...
That's 6 minutes that they don't have.
That's a very, very smart play.
Yeah.
From them. And they've... Honestly, if you look past the first, let's say, 15 minutes, they have been in control. The start was where Besiktas tried to trade bottom lane kills and objectives for the fact that HQ was always ganking the top lane. Yeah, and that worked.
This was certainly the closest game that Besiktas has played yet today. And it's not over yet, but they did look pretty good early on. But AHQ, man, especially on the back of the rockets from and the teleporting from Westdoor, those Twisted Fate ults, there's a reason this guy's not allowed to play that champion very often.
And you have to give credit to Thaldren, too, for coming through in an incredibly gank-heavy lane.
Yeah, Mountain. No. Mountain trying to escape the enemy jungle. Theocles says no, he dodges the ult. There's a double knock up here as Mountain just tries to engage, waiting for that team to come in. Here comes Westdoor, teleporting in. Doesn't really get a gold card off on anyone that I saw, but they might be able to get this mid lane tier 2 anyway, so it doesn't really matter a whole lot.
Nardius spell shielded the gold card.
Ah, okay, yeah. There you go.
No stun actually landing.
Yep.
But Thaldren, he did get a lot of empty lane farm. His team definitely helped him out after he came to that big deficit. But since that point, he's played defensively, actually managed to get a pretty substantial farm lead here and keep himself relevant in this game.
Yeah, sadly for him, though, he probably won't get to have a big team fight where he can use all this farm he just picked up because AHQ have control of the map, and there's no reason for them to stop 1-3-1-ing and just looking for picks.
Yeah, they can just split push
bubbles
and then disengage whenever things get a little bit too dicey.
Every single time. So they are basically deciding now, when do we want to make a play? Because they can just wait for Baron as well.
Yeah.
Ward up that topside jungle completed from Besiktas' side, and then just have a ping on the Baron itself. Push in every single lane at once. And you can even just put down your Rek'Sai and your Jinx and Janna, and you take that Baron super easy while the Gnar and TF is like pushing around, trying to be annoying. So AHQ has so many different ways of playing out this game.
Yeah, so far they're doing it pretty methodically too, but looks like they may start clearing things out around this Baron right away.
Scumbag Westdoor just honest the Rift Scarlet.
You gotta use a card on something, right? The Rift Coward, you mean?
Oh, you can hit the Baron if you're a man.
You don't do that. Albus is in there, man. You gotta protect your support, you know? Make sure they get a lot of kills. 109 this game for Albus, actually. That's not bad.
Certainly not, but those recalls right there actually cost them quite a bit in terms of vision. They allowed Besiktas to get into the river and take the Scuttle Crab. I think that could have been a little tighter in terms of not having a mass recall right there.
They have the wards placed in the jungle of Besiktas here, so they gotta use the timing. You can see Westdoor, as we mentioned, he doesn't need to be at the Baron. He can always just push the side wave, and he will have the ulti to join in time, as long as he moves from the bottom lane, because obviously he won't reach all the way to Baron.
But that's the problem, right? Because he doesn't have Ghost this game. And a lot of the time, if you want to split push bottom lane with a Twisted Fate this late, where Baron is a major objective, it really helps to have that Ghost so that you can get into position to get your port off. So there's still an opportunity here, I feel, for Besiktas to actually punish this.
That's a good point. Well, Besiktas trying to just get as much presence around the Baron pit as they could for the moment, but now backing off. You know, again, at some point you do need to deal with this split push. Mountain also just taking everything in their jungle, so Besiktas kind of torn between a bunch of different locations at the map at the same time. And here we go, Westdoor popping that ultimate. A flash used for double doge. He's going to get caught anyway. Oh, that's a lot of damage coming in from TF. Meanwhile, Energy comes in, gets taken down. That's a double kill now for Westdoor. And they're not done yet. AHQ moving into the enemy base. Nardius trying to stay alive. Can't quite do it. I don't know. You watch these team fights at this point, and doesn't look like there's a whole lot that Beşiktaş can do unless they're the ones getting that great engage themselves. They can't fight reactively.
No, they're just completely split up here. Dumbledore was on the other side of the wall around the Raptors and just got caught out instantly from Westor. So it's too easy for HQ to simply decide when do we want to fight and can we just get a very quick pick when the fight starts to make sure we have the advantage. So just another good setup. And honestly, they're just playing it very slow. They're waiting for Beşiktaş to move out of the base to try and ward up that Baron, and then they look for these picks. They've been controlling the side lanes nearly all game long. This is the first time I see Beşiktaş's minions push down to a tier 2 tower of AHQ, and they're now obviously just going to run straight up there, clear it out, and go back to bait around the Baron.
That's right. Don't forget next, guys, SKT versus TSM. Feels closer than ever. That's going to be an awesome game. But first, we need to decide HQ versus Beşiktaş. Let's just take a look at that fight one last time. Again, Westor coming up big once again.
Yeah, they use the Sivir ult to disengage, but Westor has so many items right now that it's not even a problem for him to basically one-shot the Morgana right there.
Yeah.
They're able to catch up nearly immediately as well. Westor throwing wild cards from the back, but even that disengage from the explosive cast and can get up and on top of Nardius.
Yeah. And a Cassiopeia teleport is just not very effective.
Yeah, that's
I mean, that's obviously one of her problems as a top laner when you do teleport into a fight, because typically you want to be there, you want to sit in the back line already when the fight starts. Together with your team, you have that ulti there to defend and you have that insane amount of single target damage. You have to realize to kite out targets. Like, you don't want to be the guy teleporting in the middle of a fight as a Cassiopeia.
Unless you have a Zhonya's.
That could be the only one.
Right, because if you have the Zhonya's Hourglass, at the very least, you can teleport in, get your ult off, perhaps, in a theoretical world.
Yeah, you're just not using her effectively at all.
I agree, but
in any way,
that's about the best option you have for a TP.
And that's just another one of these problems for Beşiktaş in terms of stopping that split push. Because if you put that Cassiopeia in the side lane, she has to use that teleport into the fight. She's not there with your AD carry sitting together and making it super hard for HQ to dive onto them. And you never really get to use that high single target damage you do have from Thaldrin here.
No one's scared of Cassiopeia flanks either.
That's true. Westor.
Very effective.
Enemy jungle. Nope, he's going to come in.
Oh!
Onto Thaldrin. Oh, gets stunned immediately. Oh, he's Zhonya's the rocket, though. Thaldrin would have been hit by that. There we go. A kill for Thaldrin. Managed to outplay Westor. And meanwhile, another fight happening in the enemy jungle. Mountain Elvis trying to push people away. Where is On? He's doing a lot of damage to Dumbledore. Going to be able to get a kill there at least, but he needs to get to the rest of his team right now. Mountain actually manages to take out Nardius on his own, and Theocles goes down. Another double kill for An as they push into the base. This is going to be another inhibitor. This might just be the game right here.
We just don't get to see that 5-on-5.
Not a lot.
There's always someone being split up here, and therefore either Westor or Ann can just be the big carries in the team fights in terms of damage from AHQ here.
Yeah, whoa, Energy wants a big revenge. Ignite, it does the job, and Energy manages to get a little bit of a pride kill there. That helps a little bit. Makes me feel a little bit better, you know?
And playing a pick comp when somebody has to be back defending super minions is one of the easiest things in League of Legends. Yes,
pretty much.
Westor did get soloed right there by Thaldrin, but the intention was absolutely right just to keep on pushing this game towards its conclusion.
Yeah.
And AHQ, honestly, should just go back to this Baron here.
Yes.
Because that's how you force Beşiktaş out of their base, and you know they're going to be split up because, like, the support is trying to clear ward over the Baron wall while you're AD carries, like, trying to push out the mid lane, and like, they will always have multiple things they have to do around that Baron to stop HQ from simply just taking it. And that's just gonna create that easy, easy pick, and meanwhile, nobody's gonna stop the push in the bottom lane, properly at least.
Mountain manages to find himself some action. The enemy jungle, Westor coming in onto Nardius. Nardius taking a lot of damage. Oh, actually, Westor taking a lot. There's the Zhonya, Ziv coming in to try to support, but here comes the rest of Dumbledore. Comes in with a pretty big health. That's three men. Gonna Zhonya's. Who's he gonna catch? A couple people. Meanwhile, Westor goes down. The ult from Theocles cleans that one up. Meanwhile, war action in the mid lane. Ziv brings in the ult, but is enough energy with that Zhonya's and Albus coming up with Ann as well. That's a double kill now for Jinx. There goes energy. Make that a triple kill. And Thaldrin, is he gonna give him the quadra? Not quite. Mountain takes that one, and that is an ace. And I think that may be the end of the game right there. And so Bezhikchas, a valiant effort early on, but it looks like AHQ is going to end the day 2-1 and really position themselves well to make it into the playoffs.
I'm still a little bit worried about AHQ. Yes, they
we'll
got
see.
That Baron.
It's a good start. There goes the Nexus. That is it. GG, AHQ takes it. So Bezhikchas, for them, their AD carry, the Chronicles of Nardius, has been a tragedy so far. But there's a couple books left, so we'll see what happens.
That is true. Just simply once Bezhikchas start falling behind in terms of towers, it became really hard for him to do anything, because they never got to use the comp in the 5-on-5 teamfights. I like the start, honestly. I like the adaptation, saying, we can't defend this top lane. He's going to get killed 1v3 nearly every single time. So we adapt and we start going for bottom lane on the bottom side of the map. I like that adaptation at least. Hmm. Problem was, by that time, AHQ had already gotten down out of turrets and could really start using West Door to get onto tier 2 towers and impact them even more.
And while I really liked how we saw AHQ play out those skirmishes and play out the split push, like I was saying about that Baron, the time they got Baron early, it was off of that ace, right? And then from that point out, they didn't know how to play with the vision properly. They didn't know how to really ward around the Baron or control that area to continue snowballing off that objective. With that kind of composition, it's very easy to get the wards and continue to make picks as they have to face check things, and you could just TF ult back in. So for me, that's what I want to see AHQ improving on as we go forward.
I think this Jinx pickup for Ann, too, is starting to look like a real threat that other teams may need to watch out for. Not just his mechanics, not just his positioning, but those rockets, man. It's nearly every time connecting in a very meaningful way. And so at this point, guys, for more insight into the match, let's toss it over to the analyst desk.